All right, this evening I want to preach on the subject of friendship, and specifically I'm going to focus in there on verse number 17. It says, iron sharpeneth iron, so a man sharpeneth the countenance of his friend. And this is a verse that I've heard, you know, a lot of churches will preach on this passage and kind of bring this up. And I'm not against applying scripture in many ways where it is applicable, right? I think the word of God is real deep and can be applied to many areas. But this passage in particular, I think I've heard applied in just about every possible way, it seems. They say, well, iron sharpens iron. And people say, well, iron sharpens iron, iron sharpens iron. And they kind of use that for just like everything when it comes to any type of Christian fellowship or anything like that. And, you know, it's amusing to me. I don't think it's like some horrible thing or anything like that. But when I looked at this, I'm going, you know what, though? I want to teach, what is this verse literally saying? Like, what is this talking about? Because this goes to the heart of a matter here when it comes to friendship. And I especially want the kids to be listening up, right? Because I'm going to be teaching tonight about friendships in general and about you being a good friend to others. It's important for kids and adults, but especially children that are probably going to be the ones who are creating the most new friends, maybe more so than adults, but even adults to you know, make sure that you've got good friends, that you are going to be a good friend, okay? And what does a good friend look like? And how are you going to able to be a good friend? So in verse 17, when it says iron sharpens iron, that's just a truth that it's relating this key point about friendship to, about iron being used to just sharpen other iron, right? And then it says, so a man sharpeneth the countenance of his friend. And what is the countenance of his friend? It's their face. It's how they look, right? How they appear. Well, a friend is supposed to sharpen the countenance of his friend. Now, before we say, what does that even mean? Do I get, you know, a razor and like trim up the beard, or do it, you know? No, your countenance is going to reflect your demeanor, your attitude, your even just your emotions, right? How you feel. Whether you're happy, sad, things like that. And sharpening of the countenance is going to be a bettering of your countenance. It's going to be an improvement. And what this is a friend that cares about their other friend and is going to notice when they're having problems and notice when there's something wrong and be there to help their friend and try to help fix their friend, that just as iron can sharpen iron, hey, I'm going to sharpen your countenance. It's a friend, though, that really cares at the end of the day. And, you know, this morning I brought up having that spirit and having that attitude, and this comes up a lot in my preaching of being able to serve others, just like Christ was here to serve others. But hopefully this evening you can put some of that mentality into practice and be very specific about it and start with your friends. Right, there's a servant attitude and a humble mindset that we should have just in general in our life. But when you actually think about what can I do to help people, start helping your friends. How about that? Whatever friends you have, think about what can I do for my friends? Who do I know? Who am I friends with? Am I even paying attention to them? Or do I just live my own life and everything is about me and then, yeah, but I have these other friends? You see what I mean? Because that may be you. Maybe you're too busy with everything else. Look, I know how that feels. But if you want to be a good friend, it requires effort, and it requires you to be paying attention to your friend, to see their countenance, to know that it even needs sharpening, that it needs help, that it needs some type of improvement or some whatever is going on with their life, to be able to recognize that. You get to choose the type of friend you will be. And I'm going to talk about you choosing other friends in a minute. But first, you have to decide for yourself, well, what type of a friend am I going to be? So if I'm going to have friends, whoever's going to be my friend, what type of friend am I going to be? Am I going to be the guy that's only going to call my friend when I need something? That's your choice. Am I going to be the type of friend that never ever talks to anyone. That's my friend. Now look, there's also different types of friends you can have. And I get, you know, and I get this. And I have friends that we don't have to talk all the time to just know that, like, hey, I'm there for you, right? And you could be loyal to friends and have loyal friends. It doesn't mean you have to be daily communicating or anything like that. But at the same time, if you're a friend, how, you know, what type of a friend are you going to be, right? Are you going to just let them fall off the face of the earth and just have no idea, or try to maintain some type of relationship there with your friends? And of course, you can only have, you know, kind of so many friends in general, at least ones that are going to be close friends. So a lot of what I'm going to be teaching today is mostly geared towards close friends, people that you consider to be your closest friends. Obviously, we can be friendly and have friends. I mean, I consider everyone in church my friend. I consider people, you know, other believers and other people that are similar, have similar faith to us, as my friends, right? And other people I've gone out soul winning with, and people that I just, I consider my friends. But they're not people that just I'm always going to be able to hang out with or do other things with that I consider to be like a friend relationship that's kind of this ongoing thing, right? So that's hopefully you understand the difference here and what I'm going to be just trying to focus on the most. It's your friends that you're going to be spending your time with just in general, by choice, outside, doing things together, or whatever. That's your friend that I'm referring to today. The Bible says if you want to flip back, keep your place in Proverbs 27, because we are going to come back to that. There's more in that chapter that I want to cover about friends. But you can just flip back to chapter 18 real quick. So you're choosing the type of friend that you want to be to someone else. The Bible says in Proverbs 18, verse 24, a man that hath friends must show himself friendly. So you ought to be friendly. I mean, it kind of makes sense. If I have friends, I ought to be friendly, right? You don't want to be some grump or gruff person and I don't even need any friends, right? Well, okay, fine, but if you're going to have friends, at least be friendly towards your friends. And there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. And this is the truth. This is good news. I mean, it's great having brothers and sisters, right? I mean, think about how close family can be. And most families, at least functional families or normal families, you ought to have a good relationship with your siblings, right? Brothers, sisters. Obviously, there's all kinds of situations out there in the world, and there's some bad family relationships. But just in general, you know, you grow up with your brothers and sisters, you ought to be pretty close. You're spending years together, you know, in the home, in the family, and you make these strong bonds with your siblings. But there are friends that can be even closer than a brother or than a sister, right? And those are good to have, that friend of someone that you could rely on, someone that could be loyal to you. Think about the best friend that you would want to have. Well, that's a good idea of how you should be towards your friends, right? Those types of attributes. So, and also, you know, maybe kids, if you're struggling getting friends, even in general, and I know it's harder sometimes being in a church where people live a little bit different, and you might have things that aren't as in common with kids out in the world, and maybe your parents don't even let you be friends with some kids. I know I don't let my children just be friends with whoever, right? And we'll get into that in just a little bit. But if you want to have friends, you need to start showing yourself friendly, right? You can't just stick to yourself and never talk to anyone and never introduce yourself and never get to know somebody. You got to open up and start being able to talk to people. And, you know, for some people, it might be a little bit easier than others. But show yourself friendly. Don't show yourself to be a jerk. Don't show yourself to be the type of person that no one wants to be around. If you start to notice that no one ever wants to be around you, you might want to take a look at yourself and say, why is that? Is there something that I'm doing that people just don't like at all? And you have to ask yourself, well, is it because I love God and the Bible and just want to do what's right? Or is it because I'm condescending and arrogant and I really think highly of myself and talk highly of myself and treat other people like it's a blessing for them just to be my friend, right? So consider these things. And obviously, there could be a whole million other reasons why you might be doing something that's just not very friendly to people. What does it mean to be friendly to people? Well, you're willing to give and be generous to your friends, right? You're going to be hospitable. You're going to be concerned about them, just like the iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpeneth the countenance of his friend. A friend is going to care about their friends and care about their well-being. So a good friend is going to want to know and let your friend talk and get to know your friend and what you can do for them. That is going to be a way for you to be friendly towards people and to be able to gain good friends. At least you can be a good friend. Now, just because you're that way towards other people doesn't mean that they'll automatically be a good friend to you. But just like with anything when it comes to living your life, and especially living a godly life, you can't control what other people are going to do, but you can control what you do. And we want to live the best way that we can and follow Scripture to do what's right here. Keep your place turn to Proverbs chapter 17. I'm going to read from 3 John chapter 1. Well, there is only one chapter. 3 John verse 14. The Bible reads, "But I trust I shall shortly see thee, and we shall speak face to face. Peace be to thee. Our friends salute thee." Greet the friends by name. It just closes the book of 3 John by saying, greet the friends by name. Take the time, especially when you're making friends, to get to know somebody's name. Ask people what their name is and then start calling them by their name, because that's going to show that you care. It makes things a lot more personable than other than you're like, oh, yeah, hey, you. You know, oftentimes, and I've done this probably all the time. My kids tell me, oh, yeah, hey, Dad, I made a new friend today at the playground, or I made a new friend here. I would say, what's their name? Right? And one, because I'm interested, but two, it's also to help them to know, hey, get the names of these new friends. Right? You're making friends, get their names. It's going to help to establish that relationship. And, you know, with kids, they need to kind of learn this stuff and know who it is that you're talking to and just be more friendly. And it makes it more personal when you know somebody's name. And just as a side note, hey, when people come and visit our church, ask them what their name is if you don't know them. And especially if they've been coming for a while and you don't know who they are, introduce yourself, be friendly, and get to know their name, and then greet them, start greeting them by name. I mean, this isn't in here by accident. It may just be it's a small verse. It's not necessarily focused on a lot, but it's there in the Scripture where the Apostle John is saying, hey, greet the friends by name. It's not in there for no reason. We ought to know these things. And you know, Romans chapter 16, it always has amazed me the moment that I kind of saw that in the passage. The Apostle Paul, think about how many people and how many places he's been, yet he's referring to so many individuals by name. He's traveled all over, he started churches, he's had many interactions with many different people. And yet he's listing off, you know, hey, this person says hi, this person says, greet this person, greet this person, greet this person. He just starts naming off all these different names. He doesn't just know, oh, yeah, there's some good people over in Rome. There's some good people over in Thessalonica. There's these other good people. No, he knows specifically who they are, right? He's made the time, made the effort to get to know these people, to be friends with them, to know their names, and to pray for them. He prays for his friends, and that's what we ought to do too, is when you care about your friends, you're looking at their countenance, you want to sharpen their countenance, so you pray for them as well. Proverbs 17, look down at verse number 17. The Bible says, a friend loveth at all times, and a brother is born for adversity. If you want to be a good friend, you need to be able to love your friend at all times. Not just when it's convenient for you, but you love them at all times. People will go through all kinds of different things. It may not be popular to be friends with someone based on some event or something that's going on in their life, but a friend is going to love at all times. all manner of different things. You know, in I could think of probably a lot more examples when it comes, again, to children, because children don't have the best concept, and they're most socially impressionable, especially when they're young. You know, all it takes is for one kid or the cool kids to give some reason why they don't like this other kid. It's something really stupid. It could just be as stupid as, like, the clothing they wear or something. You know, it's just, like, anything that's just out of the ordinary, or they're wearing glasses or the color of their hair or anything like that. And it's just, like, a whole group of kids could just be, like, nope, make fun of that person, have nothing to do with that person. But if you are that friend to that person who's receiving all of that criticism, hey, a friend's gonna love at all times. You ought to be loyal to your friends and be able to stand up for your friends and say, no, I am friends. You know, well, why are you doing friends with that person? No, I am friends with that person. And that's a sign of loyalty. Being loyal to your friend is a great attribute to have. You want to be a good friend to someone, be loyal to that friend. Treat that relationship as special. That's why there's some friends that can be closer even than siblings, because of that loyalty, because of that devotion of just being like, you know what, I am going to be friends with this person, and I'm going to be there for them. And sometimes friends make bad choices. Sometimes they do things that aren't right, but I'm going to be there for them. So that way, when other people, no one else wants to be around them, you know what, I'll help that person. Now, it's important to note this, and turn, if you would, to 1 Corinthians chapter 5. You should always be loyal to your friends, but not at all costs, right? You could, and what I mean by that is, you can still be there for a friend, but you have to know the biblical limits as to when it's appropriate to cut off your relationship with them, hopefully temporarily. Right? And when to love a friend enough to be able to let them know, hey, I can't continue in fellowship with you right now because you've got a significant problem going on in your life. And what this boils down to, though, that's not being disloyal. In fact, it's being loyal. It's continuing to be loyal to them, because there are times where people need to have a certain type of a punishment where they can realize how serious the error of their way is. And if you care about them, you'll be demonstrating the seriousness or the gravity of their sin by withdrawing from their company and saying, look, man, I love you. You know I love you. You're my brother. You're my sister. You know, you're my friend. However, you've got this major problem in your life right now, and I can't just sit here and enable you and pretend like everything's okay. And the Bible is telling me this is what I need to do, so this is what I'm going to do. It's not breaking loyalty to your friend. It's being loyal first and foremost to the Word of God above all other friendships. But your care for that person doesn't have to stop. It's just, what do I need to do to help that person the most? And what's going to help that person the most is a godly repentance, godly sorrow that's going to lead to repentance. That's what we want, right? So for some people, everyone wants to make justifications for their sin, and they also want to downplay, like, oh, it's not really that bad, or oh, I got things under control, oh, it's not a big problem. You know, the drunkard never wants to admit that they're a drunkard. Oh, no, it's not that bad. Oh, I just have some beers every once in a while. Oh, it's, you know, but in reality, it's like, look, man, you're getting drunk, like, every weekend. You're going, you know, whatever is happening, it's worse than they think. And oftentimes, it's going to take something, someone just going, look, this is really bad. Like, you don't even see it yourself, maybe, because you're in the middle of it. But this is how bad it is. The Bible says I'm supposed to withdraw from a drunkard, right? You're a brother in Christ. You know better. You're a saved person. You know what the Bible says about this. I can't continue to hang out with you while you're in this condition. And 1 Corinthians 5 gives us the specific sins that we do this for, that the type of sin where we're going to say, okay, I'm no longer going to be hanging out with you. It doesn't mean that you could never be friends with them in the future. Or you're just canceling it. You're ending the whole relationship. You're just saying, okay, look, you need to get right with God. And once you get right with God, great, right? I'm here for you, and I'll help you. And if you need help overcoming something, I can help you overcome that. But I'm not going to be having fellowship with you while you're in the midst of this sin. 1 Corinthians 5 lists off those things. Verse 9 says, I wrote unto you in an epistle not to company with fornicators, yet not altogether with the fornicators of this world, or with the covetous or extortioners or with idolaters, for then must you needs go out of the world. But now I have written unto you not to keep company if any man is called a brother, be a fornicator or covetous or an idolater or a railer or a drunkard or an extortioner, with such an one know not to eat. So your friend calls you up and says, hey, man, I want to go grab a bite to eat. What do you think? Right? Well, normally your friend would be like, yeah, sure, sounds great. Cool, let's meet up. Let's hang out. Let's have a fellowship together. But if they're guilty of one of these things, you know that they're involved in this, that this is something that's plaguing their life. You have to be able to love them enough to say, look, I can't, because you've got this problem. And that's one of the hardest things for a friend to do sometimes, is to be able to make that separation. But I'm telling you, it's way better than enabling. It really is. Because it's one thing, if you establish a friendship with someone, it's one thing for other people not to want to be around them. That person may not care about that. But if you're their close friend, and you're saying, no, look, really, man, this is a problem, and you've got to get this fixed. That will mean a lot. Now, it doesn't mean that they'll necessarily fix that, but it ought to have a good impact. And at the end of the day, if you really do care about your friend, you'll do what the Bible says here, because God still knows what's best for people and what's best for you. Because we all need to make sure, you know, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall. Okay? And if you think you're going to be Superman or Superwoman and I'm immune to sin and I could still be friends with this person, I don't care what they're involved with, and nothing's going to make me be tempted or fall or anything like that, you better check yourself. Because no one is above that. And the more you're around a bad influence, that bad influence is going to cleave to you. Now look, we're looking at 1 Corinthians 5 because we're all sinners. None of us are perfect. We all have our flaws. And that's why it's important to be loyal and to stay friends with people, you know, even though they're going to have flaws. And the closer you get to know someone, the more you're going to learn about the problems that they have in their life, because we all have problems, right? So the closer you get, they're going to be there. But you know what? You can still stay loyal. You can still stay faithful. You can still love that person. You can still try to help that person. But if they've got a really deep issue with one of these areas where the Bible's saying, look, you can't company with these people, but you're involved with this sin, you have to be able to draw the line and say, okay, I'm going to, you know, this is a line that can't be crossed. And I love you enough, I love the word of God, that you need to get this right. And let them know. I think it's more loving to tell them why you're not going to hang out with them other than just try to ghost them. Right? If they're your friend, tell them the reason. Say, this is why, so that they know, so they're not just like, oh, man, what a jerk. I thought they were cool or whatever, but they're really just, no, at least tell them. They might still think you're a jerk. I don't know. Hopefully not. But if you're making friends with other believers, they should at least be able to understand why you're doing what you do. Which leads me to my next point. Turn, if you would, to 2 Corinthians chapter 6. When you're choosing your friends, you ought to be choosing believers to be your friends, okay? These are people that you ought to be looking to be your companions, to have fellowship with. And if you look at verse number 14, the Bible says there, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness, and what communion hath light with darkness, and what concord hath Christ with Belial, or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? Now, I've used this, and I've heard other people use this for marriage, and it's true, and it's totally applicable for marriage, but this isn't just a verse specified for marriage. It is more than that, and in the context, it's not even talking just about marriage. So there's definitely more. It just says one of those things where, at least in my mind, you hear it enough about marriage, you might automatically just start thinking about marriage. But no, this actually means more than just for being married to someone, to not be unequally yoked together. Okay? There's multiple ways that you can yoke up with someone, and having a really good, solid BFF friendship is one way of yoking up with someone. Right? We're hanging out all the time. We're doing things together. Well, the Bible's instructing us here not to be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Because at the end of the day, how much fellowship can you have with someone who's not even saved? I mean, people who aren't saved are probably going to be living a worldly life. Why would they have a godly life if they're not even saved, right? And if it's some semblance of godly life, it's going to be a false godly life, right? For a false god, a false religion. They may not have some of the sins of the world in their life, but at the same time, you're going to have a very stark contradiction with people who believe in a false gospel. I mean, that goes to the core, it should go to the core of who you are, is your faith. Which is why, you know, I'll stress so much to people looking for a spouse, make sure your spouse is married, is saved, not married. make sure your spouse is married to you, right? That's it, but not married to anyone else. Make sure your spouse is saved. Your future spouse is saved, because that goes to the core of who you are. And you know, people don't often change that. You can't expect for someone to change that. Oh, well, they'll change it after we get married. No, just don't get married in the first place. Don't yoke up together. Don't bring that yoke upon you, because this is what the Bible's teaching us. And you shouldn't have fellowship, righteousness with unrighteousness, communion with light and darkness. Don't choose those people to be your friends. It doesn't mean you can't ever talk to people or hang, you know, like go out to eat or something. As 1 Corinthians 5 was talking about, he's saying, look, when I was talking about not going out to eat or not company with a fornicator, he specifies, I'm not just talking about like everyone out in the world, then you just have to completely isolate yourself, right? This is how we're able to go out and be able to preach the gospel and see, you know, and be able to talk to other people about the things of God, and still be able to have a normal relationship of just saying, hey, you know, everyone from work's going out to eat. We're going out to lunch. Hey, do you want to join us? Sure. They're not brothers in Christ, but you can still go out and have a meal with them, because they're just lost. They're out in the world, maybe, you know, just doing their thing. Maybe some of the people are fornicators, but he's saying you don't have to have that level of separation from them, because they don't know better. Right? They're not expected to have the same standards as a brother in Christ should have. And besides that, the whole point then is to try to be a good influence and try to lead them ultimately to Christ. That should be your goal with unbelievers. Right? It's not to be their best friend. It's to help them. It's to lead them to Christ. So we use these opportunities to go and be able to do that. But a friend is someone that you choose. I'm going to be this person's friend. Bible says in verse 17, wherefore come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you and will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. Let's go back to Proverbs. So when you're choosing friends, what type of friend do you want? Well, someone who's not involved in some major sin, first of all, someone who's saved. Also, the Bible says in Proverbs 22, verse 24, make no friendship with an angry man, and with a furious man thou shalt not go, lest thou learn his ways and get a snare to thy soul. And, you know, this is one thing specifically the Bible is saying about being an angry man. But it's also uncovering a truth that I've already mentioned, is that you're going to learn the ways of your friend. So whatever attributes your friend has, just be prepared that those attributes will, you know, you'll start to take on some of those attributes. Because if you know, whoever your best friend is, best friends will always sort of blend their personalities a little bit together, right? You still have your own personality, but that person rubs off on you, okay? So be aware, and here specifically saying like an angry, look, if someone is angry all the time, that's gonna make you irritable. It's gonna make you get angry a lot more frequently because you're around someone that's just, you know, like, it's getting mad all the time. I'm like, I'm gonna start getting mad all the time. And it's infectious, right? And if that person's your best friend, he's like, look, just, man, let that guy chill out for a while and find some happiness, and then you wanna let that person totally just bring you down. But be aware in general, right? What people, what their attributes are, kind of who their, what their character is. And if they've got some things where it's just like, you know what, I know I shouldn't really be like that person is, then don't be friends with them. Because you will start being like that person. And it doesn't mean you can't do nice things for someone or kind of help them out or whatever, but when you're choosing who's going to be my friend, you ought to take care in selecting who is going to be my friend, right? Who am I really going to make sure that I'm loyal to? Who am I going to invest my time in? Who am I going to focus on? Choose a good friend and then be a great friend to that person. But be aware that whoever it is, and like I said, we know we're all sinners, but that person is going to have an influence on you. Don't just be thinking, oh, I'm gonna, you know, save this person and make them so much better, and, you know, like kind of like a project of you fixing somebody. Because that's not really the best friendship either. Right? No, people aren't generally looking to just be like, oh, you're gonna be my friend, but really you're just gonna tell me to change everything about me, right? Like it's not what people want in a friend. Now, people might, you know, when they need help, help them, sure, right? That's what friends do. But, you know, look for people that you could just be friends with and love them and be loyal to them. And then obviously when situations come up, to be able to help them, and sometimes it might take tough love. Another truth to consider, flip back to Proverbs 19, look at verse number 4. I say this is a truth to consider, because this isn't something that's, so if I want to have a friend, then, well, let's read the verse real quick. Proverbs 19, verse number 4, the Bible says, wealth maketh many friends. Oh, so I just got to make a bunch of money, right? Then I could have a bunch of friends. Is that what that's saying? Well, that's one way of getting friends. But it's not necessarily the friends that you want to have, right? It's a lot easier to make friends when you have a lot of money. But the reason why is because people want the money and they don't care about you. So this is a truth. Like I said, we're going to read more in this passage, but these are truths now to consider. So when the Bible's saying this, hey, wealth maketh many friends, be aware of that. And that you know, you're going to try to make friends with someone who actually cares about you the way that you're going to care about them, instead of just caring about what you have or things like that. You know, I've seen it happen before, and I actually, put a stop to it, and I'd said something about it. I don't know if I should share all this or not, but, I'm not going to go into it. It's not that big of a deal at the end of the day, but just a kid stuff, right, where kids are using other kids for things, and it's just kind of like, you know, it's an important instruction, and I think all kids need to learn this. You know, maybe you have something that's really cool. You've been blessed. Your parents got you something really nice, really fancy, really cool. And then all of a sudden, you're real popular with other kids, but they don't really care about you. They care about your stuff. And this is something, just like it says here, wealth maketh many friends. Some people fall into that trap because if they've had problems making friends, they just think, oh, well, I'll just get all this stuff so I can have these friends because I want to have friends. But you don't want to have friends that don't care about you. You want to have friends that do care about you and that the stuff doesn't matter, right? That they'd still be your friends if the stuff wasn't there. Those are the people that you want to make friends with. So people who are only interested in using you for your stuff are not people you want to be friends with. Because they don't care about you. And as soon as that stuff's gone, they won't be your friends. So you don't want to start being, you know, having this emotional attachment and trying to consider someone your friend, and then they just drop you like a bad habit because you don't have that stuff anymore that they care about. Because they didn't care about you, they cared about the stuff. So we have to be aware that there's people out there like that, and especially if you have things or if you have wealth, that this is going to happen. So let's keep reading here, verse number 4. Wealth maketh many friends, but the poor is separated from his neighbor. A false witness shall not be unpunished, and he that speaketh lies shall not escape. Many will entreat the favor of the prince, and every man is a friend to him that giveth gifts. All the brethren of the poor do hate him. How much more do his friends go far from him? He pursueth them with words, yet they are wanting to him. So there's a contrast happening here in these Proverbs, specifically in Proverbs 19, verses 6 and 7. There's the one person who's generous and gives gifts. That attracts people. People like that. That is going to make friends. If you want to make yourself friendly, you know, being generous is a good idea. There's a lot of truth to that. Obviously, you're not looking for the friends that only care about the stuff or the money. But if you want to be friendly to people, being generous is a good thing. It's a good attribute to be kind to people. People respond well to that, right? They're going to like that. As opposed to here, and it brings up the poor person. Now, when it brings up the poor, I don't think it necessarily matters that the person just doesn't have a lot of money, because he's contrasting it with the person who's being generous and giving gifts. This is referring to the poor person that's, the reason why no one wants to be around them is because they're always asking for stuff. Right? They always want something. Now, the really needy person who just always wants to have something for you, people don't want to be around that. Right? That's why their friend is going to stay far away, because they're always just asking for stuff. So you see the difference here? The being the generous, it's not about having a lot of money. It's just, hey, I'm willing to just do things for people. I care about them. I'm being liberal with what I have, whatever. Everyone enjoys that. Everyone likes being around that. That's nice. That's being a good friend. But just looking, hey, man, what can you do for me? What can you do for me? What can you give me? What can you give me? Give me. No one wants to be around that. And you're going to find yourself not having many friends if that's who you are. Okay? Now, you may have needs and you may be poor. But just be a friend to somebody without asking them for things. Let them look on your countenance and try to sharpen you and help you where they see fit without having to, you know, just go around asking everybody for everything. And that's how you're going to be a good friend. And that's how you'll be able to keep friends and make friends, is when you care about the person, but you're not just trying to be a burden to people. And don't take this the wrong way. It's not like you could never ask a friend for something. But this proverb is talking about people who, look, their brethren hate them. You know, it says all the brethren of the poor do hate him. Now, look, the brethren are probably also poor, but they hate that guy, right? How much more do his friends go far from him? He pursueth them with words, yet they are wanting to him. There's a lesson to be learned here, and this goes to the heart also, just being a good friend. Not just asking people for everything. No one wants to be around you. Be open, be sharing, be giving with what you have. And every man is a friend to him that giveth gifts, right? It doesn't have to be a bunch of money. How about you just make something for your friend? You could make cookies or something, you know, whatever. Like, the smallest of things can go a long way. It's not about having the money. It's just being nice to people, being friendly, where the friends comes from. Being friendly, that's what it means to be friendly. You're deciding who you want to be your friend. Stay away from the people that want to use you as friends, because the people who want to use you aren't going to be loyal. Samson found that out the hard way. Samson was someone who used someone to be his friend. About, you don't have to turn there, but in Judges 14:20, the Bible says, but Samson's wife was given to his companion whom he had used as his friend. Do you remember that story where he goes down and he has the riddle and everything else with his wife, and then she ends up talking and getting the answer out of him, and he's got to pay up the debt for the gambling that he was doing, and all that drama happened. And he just gets mad, and he's just like, he leaves, right? But he's still married to this woman, but then it's like he leaves, and his wife is given to another man. It says to his companion, but it doesn't say his friend. It was his companion he had used as his friend. Well, you know what? If you're going to use someone as your friend, they're not going to really stay loyal to you now, are they? Mm-hmm. If you're just being used by somebody, they're not going to have the heart to be loyal. Whereas a real friend would have been like, no, I'm not taking her to wife. That's Samson's wife. Mm-hmm. That's his wife. I'm not going to take her. But he's like, Samson just used me anyway. Sure, I'll take her to be my wife. No loyalty to Samson. You don't want to have friends in your life that don't have that loyalty or that just want to use you for something. You know, it may feel good temporarily to, oh, man, these people like me, but they don't really like you. It's false. It's fake. If they only care about other things, if they're only using you. So beware of that. Now, turn if you would to Matthew chapter 11. I want to shift gears slightly here when it comes to making friends and who we should be our friends. We're choosing friends. And if we look to Jesus as our example, you know, Jesus chose his friends. Excuse me. He chose his disciples, which he spent all his time with. Now, you could argue and say, yeah, but they had a job. Yeah, they did have a job, right? He was discipling them, but to be like him, right? And he is the master. He, of course, has something to teach. I mean, he's the level of friendship that we have with God is a little bit different than maybe the friendship that we might have with another human being. God's perfect. God's our master. He's our Lord, right? We are his servants. So it's not exactly the same thing because I'm not the master over my friends. We're just friends. We're on the same playing field. But one of the cool things about Jesus, though, is that he does call us his friends, and he calls us his brother. So he has humbled himself and allowed us to be exalted, to be on a level. Obviously, we're not God, but to give us this type of a good, close relationship with him, which is pretty amazing. But one of the things I just want to dispel quickly is this concept. I'm sure you've all probably heard this, where people say, you know, if Jesus were here, he'd be hanging out with the prostitutes and going to the bars and hanging out with people. It's like, no, he wouldn't. Okay, it's people who don't know Jesus make that statement. Amen. Yeah. That's right. They don't know the Bible. They don't know the God of the Bible. They don't know Jesus himself. Right. And they make stupid comments like that. Oh, yeah, well, you know, because he did shame the Pharisees. They'll say, but they'll apply that to like all religion. It's like, no, they were hypocrites, right? And there's a reason why he called them out and called them devils and everything, because they were. But who he spent his time around, it wasn't all the derelicts and drunks and people like that. His disciples were hardworking men. He called them from work. Like, literally, they're on the boat fishing. Hey, come follow me. And they drop their tools and are like, all right, I'm going to go follow Jesus now. Right? Those are the people that he chose to be his disciples. And look, none of them are perfect. Of course not. But it's a far cry from the people that some out in the world are going to say, oh, yeah, Jesus, he wouldn't care. Yo, he'd be passing the joint around or going to the bar or whatever. People say some really stupid, blasphemous things. But this is so easily shown to be wrong from Scripture. If you look at Matthew chapter 11, verse number 16. Because here's the thing, though, is that it's ironic. It's ironic because the things that people will say today, Jesus was actually accused of those things when he was on this earth. But it's funny, if you just look at Scripture, it was an accusation, it wasn't true. right? So Jesus being this, a glutton and a drunk and stuff like that, he wasn't those things, but they accused him of those things. Look at verse 16. The Bible says, "But whereunto shall I liken this generation? It is like unto children sitting in the markets and calling unto their fellows and saying, we have piped unto you and ye have not danced. We have mourned unto you and ye have not lamented. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he hath a devil. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, behold, a man gluttonous and a wine bibber." Look at this. "A friend of publicans and sinners." So they're, in the context, he's likening this generation to people who are just never satisfied, right? Because he's saying, on the one hand, you've got John, he's eating locusts and honey, in the wilderness. He's not having any type of luxury whatsoever. He's not having the juice. He's not eating a lot of food. We say, oh yeah, that guy's got a devil. But then on the other hand, you have Jesus who's living, I guess, a more normal life in the sense of he is partaking of having juice. He is eating normal meals. And so, oh yeah, he's a glutton and a wine bibber. Like, no, he wasn't those things. But as those things, he wasn't. It says, a friend of publicans and sinners. No, he wasn't. Now, it depends on how you want to define friend, right? You can say he's a friend of sinners because we're all sinners, right? And there's songs that talk about that and stuff too. Fine. Like, I'm okay with that in that one context or understanding. But Jesus was not just this friend of, like, the lowest of the low, where he's just hanging out with people who are really wicked, okay? Whether that be the drunkard or the glutton, the covetous, right? Those people he wasn't friends with. They weren't his friends. It doesn't mean he didn't try to minister to them. It doesn't mean he didn't try to talk to them. It doesn't mean he didn't try to get them saved, but they weren't his friends. His friends were the people who he was spending all his time with. His friends were those disciples. His friends were Mary and Martha, right? And Lazarus were his friends. They were godly people. You say, well, what about Mary Magdalene? Well, turn to Luke chapter 8. Because this is where they like to throw in a little bit of scripture. And they'll say, well, Mary was a prostitute and Mary, so all this other stuff. It's like, yeah, she was. Or, people were these things. It's not that you can never be friends with someone who's had a checkered past. But what matters is, how are you living now? Right? And what direction are you going? That's what matters. You can be friends with anyone who's had any type of background or past. That's not an issue. And that's not what I'm saying. So 1 Corinthians 5 also isn't talking about, well, anyone who's ever been a fornicator, you can't put away from among yourselves that wicked person. No. They're involved in it right now. Like, this is what they're doing right now. Those are the people that you're not going to remain friends with until they get that right, and then you can restore that relationship back together and make it right again. Luke chapter 8, verse number 1, the Bible says, "And it came to pass afterward that he went throughout every city and village, preaching and showing the glad tidings of the kingdom of God, and the 12 were with him. And certain women which had been healed of evil spirits and infirmities, Mary called Magdalene, out of whom went 7 devils, and Joanna, the wife of Chusa, Herod's steward, and Susanna, and many others, which ministered unto him of their substance." So these people were around Jesus, ministering unto him. And it mentions Mary Magdalene, and it says, yeah, out of her went 7 devils. She wasn't hanging around him while she had the devils. Like, it's not like she's just, hey, Mary, how's it going? Let's go out and have it, and let's hang out together. Let's spend a bunch of time together. And she's still just possessed with devils and living a crazy life and doing all these things. No, he healed her. He cast out the devils. And you know what happens when the devils are cast out? It's actually in the same chapter. Look down at verse number 35. Talking about, remember the man who was in the tombs and had the legion? He was possessed of many devils. Verse 35 says, "Then they went out to see what was done," talking about the people of the town, after he cast out legion out of that guy, and they ran into the herd of swine, and the herd of swine commit suicide into the water. and came to Jesus and found the man out of whom the devils were departed, sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. So when the devils are cast out, guess what? He's in his right mind now. He's clothed. He's no longer naked. Okay? He's clothed, and they're just like, wow, we don't know this guy like this. We know the naked guy who's breaking chains and screaming and acting nuts and a lunatic out in the wilderness, right? But now look at him. Look at the change. Unfortunately, that's true. There's probably a lot of people who are possessed out in San Francisco that are out defecating on streets and all this other stuff, right? But hey, if someone gets in the right mind, right? Like, those aren't the people who are going to be like, oh, yeah, that's my friend. Like, we hang out regularly. I talk to him on the phone. These guys are possessed with devils and stuff. That's not who you're just making friends with. But after they're healed, right, now they're in the right mind. Now, yeah, sure. Hey, and this guy, specifically, he wants to follow Jesus. He's going the right way. Would there be any problem with now becoming friends with this man? No. That's great. Hallelujah. Praise God. I'll be your friend. I'll help you out. Right? But it's not what they were. It's not like he's making these friends that are just continuing to be involved in this wickedness. Right? They get healed. Great. And furthermore, just and turn if you would to John chapter 15. The Bible teaches in James 4:4, ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Amen. So what the world is pushing out, what the world has to offer, all the things of the world, you know, we ought not to view those things as like, hey, I'm in line with that. I'm a friend of the world. I love the world, because that makes you the enemy of God. I think it stands to reason that if there's people out there that are just really worldly and they live for the things of the world and they're of the world, that we shouldn't have friendship with those people either, because that's at enmity with God. Those aren't the friends we should be choosing, and those aren't the friends that Jesus chose. Jesus chose his disciples, and you know, I can't say all of them because I can't prove it from Scripture, but what I know for a fact, like Andrew was already following the Apostle John, or John the Baptist, right? He was already listening and was like a disciple of John the Baptist, and then he finds out about Jesus and becomes Jesus' disciple. And other people, these other disciples, I believe, other than Judas, they were probably already saved anyways. And he chooses them to be his disciples. Because they're already talking about, hey, this is the Messiah. We found him. How would they know that before they, you know, like they knew that? Because they were looking for a Messiah. They're looking for the Christ. Because they cared about the things of God. Because they were spiritual people. They were saved people. It's not like all of a sudden when Jesus showed up, then people started getting saved. People have been getting saved since Adam. And even when Jesus was alive on this earth, they were still getting saved by putting their faith in the Lord. And those are the people that Jesus chose to be his friends, and to, not just his friends, but his disciples. John 15, he's gonna explain a little bit about his friendship. Verse number 12, the Bible says, this is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. That's the most love you could have, is laying down your life for your friends. Amen. Ye are my friends, if you do whatsoever I command you. Amen. Jesus has a little stipulation. Now look, I'm not saying, kids, that you need to have friends that are going to do whatever you tell them to do. Like I said, it's a little bit special with Jesus, okay? But he is putting a criteria on here too, isn't he? Does it sound like he's friends with the drunkards that are singing the songs of fools in the bars? No. No, he wants them to get right with God. You know, and if they're saved, of course he wants them to get right with God, but he's not just going to call them his friends. You're my friends if you do whatsoever I tell you, I command you, right? Henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends, for all things that I have heard of my Father I have made known unto you. So what he's expressing here, what the reason why he's calling them friends is because they are his servants. But he said, the reason why I'm calling you friends, though, is because a servant doesn't have to know. Like the boss tells the servant to do stuff and doesn't have to explain it to the servant. The servant just says, yes, sir, and does the work that the boss says. They don't have to know why they're doing what they're doing. But Jesus is saying, no, look, I'm calling you friends. Yeah, I'm telling you what to do. I'm giving you these commandments, but I'm also explaining why, and I'm giving you all of the information. I'm sharing this information with you so that I'm treating you like a friend, not just your boss, right? They are his servants. He is the master. He is the Lord. But he's like, I'm also just sharing everything with you. I'm telling you about all this stuff because I care about you. You're my friends. You're not just my servants. You're my friends. And that's how he kind of establishes that relationship. And, you know, the friends are going to warn you about God's judgment, even from Jesus Christ. Turn, if you would, to Luke 16. Don't turn to Luke 16. Go back to Proverbs 27. I'll read for you from Luke 12. Luke 12, verse number 4, the Bible says, "And I say unto you, my friends, be not afraid of them that kill the body, and after that have no more that they can do. But I will forewarn you whom ye shall fear. Fear him which after he hath killed hath power to cast into hell. Yea, I say unto you, fear him." Jesus is speaking, saying, I say unto you, my friends. He's saying, don't be afraid of the people of the world, but be afraid of God. Speaking spiritual truths and talking about the Lord and warning people who are your friends is a good idea. Amen. Again, you know, it may be uncomfortable. Jesus wasn't worried about making them uncomfortable when he's like, hey, you know who you ought to fear? Fear the guy that could cast both soul and body into hell. Fear that guy. Amen. Right? Like, and we ought to, if we're good friends, we ought to tell our friends things that they need to hear. If there's something they need to hear, like in this case, they needed to hear the message of not being afraid of man, but just fearing God. Right? That was the point he's getting across. Don't be afraid of what man could do to you, but fear God. I mean, he's the one you got to fear, not man. And that was his way of encouragement, but he's still bringing up the things of God and the things of the Bible. Good friends are going to do that. Proverbs 27, I want to close on this concept here of recognizing a good friend when you have one. Okay? We know that we ought to be friendly. We ought to have a good attitude. Be a friend to people means being friendly. It means, you know, be generous, be considerate of them, be thinking about your friends, looking how can you help them, sharpen them. Right? What can you do for your friends? Deciding to stay loyal. Say, I'm going to be loyal to my friend. It is a decision. It doesn't just happen because it gets tried when there is some type of a conflict. Or maybe they do something that upsets you. You say, you know what? I'm still going to stay friends with this guy. I don't care. You know, yeah, I'm upset, whatever. We had this fight or this problem, but they're my friend. And I'm going to stay loyal. I'm not just going to not be friends with them because they just did something I didn't like or whatever. We had this drama. We had this problem. I'm going to stay their friend. Okay, that is what you need to do to be a good friend. And also then understand, because it is a loving thing to be able to point out when someone's in, and look, no one likes the holier-than-thou person that's just always going to criticize and tell you all the things that you're doing wrong in your life. Don't be that friend. Please. Because that might be another case where you find yourself having no friends. But there are times when it is appropriate, of course, to be able to point out a flaw, you know, a serious flaw in your friend, where you're going to try to help that person. And you know the difference when it really comes from a genuine, sincere concern of, hey, you know, I really don't think you're going down the right path here. Like, I don't think this is good for you. Right? And those types of things, obviously not a 1 Corinthians 5 thing, but just some other area of their life, you can still be friends. Be like, you know, I'm going to be loyal to you and be friends with you. I just don't think this is good for you. And I'm going to point this out and I'm going to show you that. And someone might even need to be rebuked. The Bible says in Proverbs 27, verse 5, open rebuke is better than secret love. And it's true. It's better. Someone just loving you in secret, that doesn't really benefit you at all. It's better to have someone openly rebuke you. Because if you need a rebuke, you need a rebuke. Right? We all need that from time to time. And then it says in verse 6, faithful are the wounds of a friend, but the kisses of an enemy are deceitful. You know, you say, well, kisses sound better to me, but not if it's from an enemy. Right? Well, do you want a kiss from Judas? Seriously. That didn't work out so well. Right? I'd rather have my friend tell me something I don't necessarily want to hear at the time than getting a kiss from someone like Judas. Faithful are the wounds of a friend. Why? Because your friend, if your friend's a good friend, if your friend cares about you, and this is how you recognize a good friend, you need to be able to realize, you know what? They're just saying this for my benefit. And you ought to be able to take a step back. If someone says something that, if someone rebukes you, your friend rebukes you, and it comes across as like, well, who do they think they are? Blah, 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 blah. You know, like, you may get angry at first, and I understand that, but that's our flesh, right? That's our pride. That's our flesh. Take a step back if someone's done that to you, and just consider. Now, even if they're wrong, consider, hey, this person was willing to put our friendship on the line, knowing that it might get me really upset, but they did it because they love me. Okay? That should mean something to you. If someone's willing to rebuke you and willing to kind of risk a friendship by saying something that's uncomfortable, consider that as being a good friend. Because a person who really cares about you will say things that are uncomfortable if it's needed. Verse number 9, Bible reads, ointment and perfume rejoice the heart. Ointment, perfume, you know, that could be nice and make people happy, smell a good smell, whatever, right? That's what's talking about rejoicing the heart. So doth the sweetness of a man's friend by hearty counsel. Counsel is advice. So that's also a reason to rejoice when you can be a good friend to someone and provide good advice for them and sound biblical, godly advice and wisdom for your friend. That's sweet. That's good. If you have a friend that you can do that with, that can do that for you and be there for you and help you get good advice, man, keep that friendship alive. Keep that friendship. Be friendly to that friend for sure. Right? Because they're already exhibiting that they're a good friend to you. And how about you being able to then offer up advice to your friends? Right? But how are you going to know that? Without considering them first, without thinking about them and just having them in your mind and in your heart. Verse 10, thine own friend and thy father's friend, forsake not. Don't forsake your friends. So don't forsake your father's friends. Right? The family friends. Be good to them. Don't forsake them. Neither go into thy brother's house in the day of thy calamity, for better is a neighbor that is near than a brother far off. And that's true too. Right? You may have family like me. I have family all over the place. Right? None of my family is here other than my immediate family. I've got family members. I got brothers and parents and in-laws, and everybody is just all over the United States. But in a day of calamity, what's calamity? I mean, like a disaster? Hey, something like everything's going wrong. It's a lot easier and could be better to just have the friend that's near, right? The neighbor that's near, someone that's right there. And how are you going to have that, though, if you're not being friendly to people, right? If you just want to isolate yourself and not have friends, you don't have that. And there's going to come a time we all need a friend, right? So start being friendly to people so you can have friends and be good friends for them so that when they have the calamity, you can help them and just be right there and be like, yeah, I'll help you out. And, you know, of course, the Bible is true. What you reap, you know, you're gonna reap what you sow. Whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. You sow good things and being good friend and being good to people, making good friends, being a good friend to them. It will, God will see that and it'll come back to you. Even if your friends aren't good to you, God will still be there for you when he sees you exhibiting that behavior towards others. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Dear Lord, we love you. Thank you so much for the great truths and wisdom found in the scripture. I pray you please help us to be good friends, Lord, to make good friends, to be good friends, and to choose good friends, dear Lord. We love you. We appreciate the wisdom that's given to us in scripture. And just pray for your guidance. Help us to understand more. and also to have the courage to put these things into practice, that we can be the best friends, even if it may be uncomfortable from time to time, but still be able to do the things that are right. And Lord, we love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.